Ah, yes, Mr. Vegan. We see once again that there is nothing you possess that I cannot take away.
Dr. Villainous McBad Guy. The evil rival I've totally had this entire time, and if you say I haven't, then you're wrong and I'm suing you. How did you find me?
I simply alerted the local neighborhood watch slash bingo group to the presence of a strange man in a hat stalking through garages with a whip. There are 30 angry senior citizens on their way here to scold you. Now, hand over the game, please.
Too bad all those seniors don't know you the way I totally do. And again, don't say I don't. I have lawyers.
Yes, too bad. You could warn them, if only you spoke angry senior citizen.
Yeah. Hey, look, a distraction!
What?
There, I don't see anything.
Hey!
Hello?
Grace!
This is Grace.
Get the car running!
Alright, well, give me a second.
Hurry up!
Hang on, you need to be patient.
Grace, I have a mob of angry seniors after me. I cannot afford to be patient. Now get the car running!
But I'm on my lunch break.
Now!
Alright, fine. Where is he?
Get moving! Cassis! This will not be the last you'll see of me! Yeah, Mom? I need you to come pick me up.
Well, all in all, I consider that trip a success.
You stole a game from someone's garage and then you got chased down by angry seniors.
Not just any game. According to ancient fan legends, this game contains a map to the greatest treasure that any Indiana Jones fan could ever ask for. Hidden away for years, destined to be discovered by only the most worthy of fans.
Well, what is it?
Fortune and glory beyond your wildest dreams!
Okay, yeah, but what is it?
Well,
you don't know, do you?
Okay, well, no, I don't know what it is.
Of course.
But that doesn't matter, because we're gonna find out.
How?
By playing through the game! But first, a history lesson.
I'll just leave.
Indiana Jones and the Emperor's Tomb is a 2003 action-adventure game developed by The Collective and published by Lucasarts for the Xbox, PlayStation 2, and Microsoft Windows. The game was announced by Lucasarts in 2002, where they stated that the game was being developed by The Collective, who are not a dystopian totalitarian government, but are actually a defunct game company. The Collective's previous works included Men in Black the Game and Buffy the Vampire Slayer, this game being built on an enhanced version of that game's engine. Which is kind of irrelevant, but I think it's funny. Upon release, the game received mixed reviews from most critics of the time, with many praising it for its well-designed gameplay and ability to capture the feel of the movies, while criticizing it for its camera controls and graphics. Contemporary reviews had a much more positive opinion of the game, saying that it held up quite well. But despite this, this game seems to have become lost and forgotten amongst other Indiana Jones games. But did it deserve this fate, or does it belong in a museum alongside other fan-favorite games? Well, with a new Indiana Jones game on the way, and me personally beyond excited for it, I see no better time to check this game out. So, let's go on an adventure and take a look at Indiana Jones and the Emperor's Tomb.
So we load up the game, and after the developer logos, we get a trailer for some reason. I don't entirely know why this is here, but it definitely makes the game look pretty hype. After watching a commercial for the game that I'm playing, we get sent to the title screen. I make a few preliminary adjustments, such as turning on subtitles and setting the game to the highest difficulty. Because, you know, pro gamer. When you navigate around the options menu, the game will actually pan around the room to different artifacts and items. It's a small detail, but I think it's pretty neat. Alright, before I get distracted by something else, it's time to begin the actual game. First, we name our save file. I tried to write the usual important message for the name, but I couldn't fit all of it, so, don't forget to subscribe, I guess. The actual game opens with Indy in the jungles of Ceylon, or modern-day Sri Lanka. The name of the place isn't really relevant, but I had to look this up because I didn't know what a Ceylon was, and now you get to know too. He's hunting for something called the Idol of Kuruwatu, hidden somewhere within this lost city. After checking the map, we finally begin actual gameplay. The controls are roughly what you would expect from a game like this. Left analog stick to move, right analog stick controls the camera, A button, or circle I guess because I'm playing the PS2 version, to jump, stuff stuff like that. This opening segment serves mostly to introduce the player to the basics of gameplay. The platforming feels alright, but I'm not a huge fan of the jumping. It's not the smoothest thing in the world, and it feels kinda clunky. I kinda get used to it after a while, but what I can't get used to is the constant breathing. Whenever you run or jump or do basically anything even remotely strenuous, Indy will start breathing like he's just run a marathon, and for some reason it is the loudest thing in the whole game. This is constant throughout the game and it's really annoying. Anyway, we learn a few more vital mechanics, such as using Indy's canteen to heal and refilling it at these fountains, or picking up random weapons and items. We also learn how to use Indy's iconic whip to swing over gaps. You cannot do this in real life, trust me, I have tried.
Alright, so, I'm gonna try to get that branch up here. I got an actual whip, $40 on Amazon. This is where all the budget for this video went. Okay, here we go. Did not expect that. Wait a minute, tear this thing
down. Wait, how did I get it out though?
That's a good question, actually.
Oh no. Oh no.
That made it worse.
That made it worse. Oh no. So that we wrapped it, Reagan! Now we might not have a whip.
Well, yeah, I've lost my prop for the video now.
But you can't leave it in a tray.
Well, I know that.
Well, get it down.
We move on from the tutorial area and enter deeper into the Lost City. Here we encounter some ivory hunters, the first enemies in the game. Coincidentally, this is where we get our first taste of the game's combat system, and it is certainly one of the combat systems of all time. There's a quick attack, a heavy attack, combos, blocks, simple stuff like that. The actual fighting itself isn't that bad. Violence is fun! What a shock! The main problem is the enemies. They are massive damage sponges. It takes so many hits to take down even the simplest enemies. I have stabbed this man in the chest with a machete at least a dozen times now. How is he not dead? Also, when they do finally die, the bodies just phase out of existence before your very eyes. Is this a simple way to remove unnecessary elements from gameplay in order to reduce processing stress, or something deeper? You decide. Even though it's probably the former, because that's the most obvious one, really, when you think about it like that. So anyway, we continue onward, speeding up a few more enemies and learning some more movement mechanics, such as climbing vines and shimmying on walls. The level design for much of this area essentially amounts to just trying to find the way forward. It isn't perfect by any means, but it is pretty fun to jump around these ruins in search of a path. I steal a shotgun off of an enemy's corpse before heading onwards. Opening this door releases some enemies, allowing us to get properly acquainted with this game's gunplay. You learn very early on in this game that guns are going to be your best friends. They can take down most enemies in only one or two shots, at least in the early game, have great range, and because the game will lock onto enemies for you while shooting, as long as you can see them, you won't miss. The only real problem is the lack of ammunition. Ammo is very scarce. Enemies only drop it rarely, and the breakable crates thrown around the level seem to drop it even less. Maybe I'm just missing them when they drop, though, because the pickups for them are tiny. After dealing with that, I head into the next area, where I complete more platforming and discover the benefits of whip-based combat.
It's not too late to whip it!
I next blow up a door, basically desecrating a 1,000-year-old piece of history in the process. But hey, if whatever ancient culture lived here didn't want me to blow up their architecture, they would have told me so. The next combat arena is the first real challenge I face, as I entered it with very low health and no ammo. I die a few times before realizing the greatest tool that I have in my arsenal. The enemy's own stupidity. Yeah, the AI in this game is not very smart nor aware of their surroundings. You can literally run right past them as loud as possible and they will not notice. You can make combat situations easier by taking enemies on one at a time. You can hide in a corner and slowly beat up an enemy before looting their non-existent corpse and moving on to the next one. This strategy is how I get through this area, and after avoiding some traps, we can head to the next section of the level. Here we get introduced to Adventure Mode, essentially just a segment where we need to hop and dodge roll to avoid some traps. It's a neat little way to break up things, even if it only lasts a few seconds, and it's probably the easiest thing I've had to do so far. After the trap segment, we enter this area, and if this giant open section of the level isn't a crummy combat sequence, then I'm not sure this is legally a video game. Luckily it is, though, meaning this is still a video game and we can keep playing. We reach this rickety old bridge and get a message advising us to take our time crossing it. Let me just check here real quick, and yeah, that's called foreshadowing. So in the most shocking twist since that pretzel I ate that one time, the bridge collapses, and now we're stuck trying to navigate the crocodile-infested river. This coincides perfectly with the introduction of a new mechanic. The ability to pick up and throw human skulls from these piles to distract enemies and trigger traps. Kinda sick, but improvise, adapt, overcome, I guess. The actual throwing mechanic is fine, it's every non-Wii sport game ever made. The little bar determines how hard you throw, time it right to throw further, you get the idea. My analytics show that you all have at least passed high school. We use the power of human remains to distract the crocs and swim down the river. I then shoot up this enemy camp and continue even deeper into the Lost City. After a quick swim through this tunnel, we can distract a few more crocs and bravely run away from this combat encounter before platforming up to this lever and opening the stone face door. What? Your house doesn't have a stone face door? Where have you been living? The next few areas consist of some pretty straightforward combat arenas and puzzles before we enter the Murder Bat Sentry area. To get through this area, we need to channel our inner spy by moving quietly to not alert the sentry nest and cap the intel. Indy is much quieter when walking on grass, which is for some reason perfectly arranged throughout this ancient temple like a Zen garden. Touching grass is not enough, however. We also need to throw skulls to trigger the sentries while we dodge roll over to the next patch of grass. This actually isn't that bad a segment. It looks cool, the path forward is clear, and there's no major issues making it unplayable. Yeah, there's some times when the skulls don't seem to distract the trap long enough and I get shot, but it's not really that big an issue. With the bat section finally complete, we can enter the treasure room. Boy, I sure hope there's no massive terrifying creatures in here, and yep, that tracks. The idol we're after is hidden inside the massive rock thing in the middle of the room. We need to deal with the crocodile and find a way to open the thing and reveal the treasure. The croc will kill you instantly if it catches you, and while you can just live with it and keep outrunning it, my anxiety doesn't want to deal with that, so instead we can trap it in this little shame corner by luring it over and pulling a lever to lock the door. Don't try to use the skulls to distract it, they do not work. I desecrated too many corpses finding that out. Once the croc is trapped and officially no longer my problem, we can platform over these conveniently placed cages and pull this lever, opening the rock thing and revealing the idol. This game takes place before Raiders of the Lost Ark, though, so Indy hasn't learned to not just blindly grab stuff off of pedestals yet, thus triggering a trap door. This is inconsequential, however, as all we have to do is cut through these vines and swim out. Also, the crocodile escapes while I'm doing this, but I'm already like a mile away from it by the time this happens, so it remains not my problem. Alright, that went pretty well, and... oh, right, this is an Indiana Jones game. This is Albrecht von Beck, a... okay, so my legal team has advised that I don't use the funny word that rhymes with Yahtzee in this video, so that I don't get smothered with a pillow in my sleep by YouTube. Basically, Beck works for the funny German mustache man, and he wants the idol we found, most likely for nefarious means. Blonde hair and blue eyes are no match for the power of a fist, however, and Indy manages to yeet Beck into the croc pond before escaping with the idol. With that, the first level comes to an end, and Indy returns to New York so that the actual story can begin. While at his day job, Indy is visited by this guy, Marshal Kai T. Chang, and his assistant Mei Ying. They're officials from the Chinese Republic, who have come to ask Indy what he knows about the first emperor of China. According to legend, the tomb of this emperor is supposedly an underground city filled with unimaginable riches. After its construction, all the workers involved with it were sealed inside, never to be seen again. So basically an early apple factory. Kai tells us about some kind of magical artifact known as the Heart of the Dragon, which sounds like a bad kung fu movie, but is actually a flawless black pearl buried with the emperor, which possesses the power to control the will of men. Seems like kind of a lame power considering you only have control of like half the population, but still. Kai says the pearl must never fall into the wrong hands, which is why Indy needs to find it. He then has his assistant smash the idol we just spent like an hour getting in the last level, revealing another artifact. This is one of three pieces of the Mirror of Dreams, which sounds like a bad self-help book, but is actually the key to the crypt within the Emperor's tomb. So basically, after showing up uninvited to Indy's office and then destroying a priceless artifact, the two request that we hunt down the other two pieces of the mirror and recover the Heart of the Dragon for them. Indy likes the idea of helping these random property-destroying strangers, and now we're off to Prague on the hunt for the other mirror pieces.
Okay, wait a second. How does this help us find this supposed treasure? We've just been sitting here playing a video game.
Well, the legends didn't say. Don't worry, I'm sure we'll find something soon. Maybe there's something in...
what is it?
It's... a map! Or... part of a map, rather. This is what we've been looking for!
Wait, if that was inside the case, then why did you spend 2 hours playing the game?
Never mind that. According to the map, we have to head to the ruins of the Collective Game Studio. We'll find the next clue there. Come on!
Some depressing ruins. Hey buddy, how's it going down there?
Why am I the one shoveling?
Quit whining. The map says there's something buried here. We'll find it eventually. You keep digging, I'll check the game for more clues.
You brought the game?
Of course I did. I have to make a video out of this somehow.
Ugh.
So anyway...
Welcome to the Prague Castle. Yes, that is actually what it's called. We're here to hunt for the next piece of the Mirror of Dreams. The castle is being guarded by the secret police. I'm calling them that because, much like the other funny German word I can't say, I'm worried that if I say it in the video, YouTube will take some inspiration from them and shoot me. We first need to deal with some of them guarding the gate and then platform into the castle grounds. This is where the major problems with this game's platforming and jumping become apparent. For starters, you don't have any control of Indy in mid-air, so you can't make any adjustments to your jump or try to course correct. So if you do a running jump, you are locked in, and you better hope there's something to land on. Another issue is that the ledge grabbing seems to only work about 75% of the time, which is annoying because most of this game's platforming segments require at least one ledge grab. Oh, and the camera! It doesn't like tight spaces. Good thing we're in a level designed around tight spaces, otherwise it might have been a problem. Luckily, the platforming isn't too much of an issue yet. Keyword. Yet. And we can slip inside the castle. There's more guards inside the castle, which gives us a chance to overhear some of their dialogue. Oh boy, I wonder what kind of witty banter these guys have.
Maybe when I'm done here, Herr Göring will give me that riding crop he promised me.
What do you mean by that?
There are multiple different ways that I could interpret that sentence, and just about all of them are bad, so let's just beat these guys up and pretend we never heard that. From here on out, enemies with guns are gonna get a lot more common, as are large groups of enemies. The best strategy I can find for dealing with them is to just run around, dealing damage where you can, and trying to deal with them one at a time instead of all at once. Otherwise, you'll get completely wrecked. Alright, now that they're dealt with, we need to venture further into... oh. That's unfortunate. So we need to get through this hallway to find the switch to open the path forward. The problem is that the entire hallway is lined with death traps that require you to dodge roll around them. This isn't too difficult if you time it right, I'm more so just in awe of how many excessively violent death traps are crammed into this hallway. There's even a dedicated hallway filled with massive rusty buzzsaws that move in and out. Who designed this place? The Pale King?
What kind of sick and twisted toy factory is this?
So anyway, after completing the Path of Pain and seeing firsthand the consequences of loving your children, sorry, wrong game, we pull the switch, which allows us to pull another switch and open the path forward. Gotta beat up some dudes first, though. Can't forget about that. Now we get to learn how much this game loves to make it totally unclear what you're able to do. Like here, for example. It looks like you can use the whip to swing on this hook, but you can't reach it from the ground. You have to jump and then swing on the hook to the other side. It is not clear at all that you can do this, and I really didn't want to try jumping and die, because then I would have to do this entire section over again, because this game is beyond stingy with checkpoints. I just figured that I was supposed to do something else, so I wandered in circles for 5 minutes before just making the leap of faith. The leap of faith thankfully works, leading us to an annoying combat encounter and a quick pseudo-puzzle involving swinging on these chains. Next, we head into the castle courtyard. This entire area is heavily guarded, with tons of secret police agents patrolling around. Fortunately, though, there's a conveniently placed MP40 for us to use, allowing us to escalate the violence. After painting the floor of this castle not red, because there are no bodies with which to supply blood for the aforementioned painting, we can blow up this grate and drop down this well. This leads to a conveniently placed secret door that sends us to the next part of the level. There's some more annoying combat before more whip swinging. This next room is full of enemies, but luckily Indy studied at the Phantom of the Opera School of Combat. Yes, I am aware I made a joke like that once already in the Ratatouille video. You try thinking of another joke involving dropping a chandelier on people. Next we use the chandelier chain to swing up here, where we open the door to a new combat encounter. Look, I know I'm playing on hard mode, but these guys are taking multiple rounds of 9mm to the face without even flinching. Panzer Schokolade just hits different, I guess. The next area is the library, where we need to locate a book to open a hidden bookshelf door, that will then open another hidden bookshelf door to allow us to progress. This, on its own, isn't very difficult. What makes it annoying is the enemies patrolling around. You see, at this point in the game, I was really getting fed up with the combat. Like I said earlier, enemies are massive damage sponges, and it takes forever to kill even one of them. Enemies also have perfect aim and infinite ammo, so they can snipe you from anywhere. They can also really easily stun lock you and drain your health down to nothing in seconds. Now, you might be saying,
well, there's a block button. Maybe the combat is fine, and you should just get good. You scrub?
I can't block a bullet, smart guy. You try parrying a Luger. See how it goes for you. Even if I do use the blocking system, it rarely seems to work or help me any. The enemies can block, though. They love to block, even though they don't need to because they can just decide that they don't want to get hit and have your attack miss completely. Then you get locked into the attack animation, and another enemy runs up behind you and stun locks you again. Thanks to all of these factors, combat encounters like the one in this library eventually devolve into running in circles praying for mercy. After spending a good 30 minutes of my life dealing with the library, we can move on to the next area, the Alchemist's Laboratory. This area contains 4 doors, each of which are unlocked by changing the time on this giant clock. We need to feed random artifacts to this demon mannequin to unlock the clock puzzle and open the doors. The first artifact is this crown, which is so easily obtainable that it's barely worth talking about. This lets us unlock the bowl door, which takes me way too long to figure out. The bowl door leads us to the castle rooftops, where it seems we're being followed by a ninja. A very bad ninja, it seems, as Indy is able to spot them quite easily. Bad ninjas aside, we need to find a broken sword to give to the mannequin demon. This is actually pretty simple, as all we need to do is platform over to this window and drop in on this guy to find the sword in the display case.
This belongs in a museum.
He said it!
With the sword in hand, we can barely manage to get through another annoying combat encounter and offer the sword to our demon friend. Another clock puzzle and we can open the sword door. This leads to more rooftops, which are guarded by a terrifying enemy known as Bad Level Design, whose special ability makes the path forward incredibly unclear and obtuse. We're actually supposed to climb down and swing over to a door to get inside this observatory area and grab a random scroll. This of course leads to more combat, but we can thankfully either run past or shoot through most of it. The scroll unlocks another clock puzzle and opens another door. Here we need to climb the castle's clock tower and use a conveniently placed glider to reach this other tower, which contains a skeleton for some unknown reason. I'm not gonna lie, I don't know what this is, nor do I know why it's just sitting in this random tower, why it was so important that it needed a poison gas booby trap, or how it relates to anything, but at least we got a cool flaming bowling ball to give to our demon friend. With one final clock puzzle, we can open the fourth door and enter the final area of the level, where we encounter the game's first boss fight, this freaky magic homunculus thing. No, I do not know why this guy was just chilling in a tube in the Prague Castle. All I know is we need to kill it. Initially, I'm not sure what we need to do here, but luckily the creature manages to get itself stuck on the floor, allowing me to figure out that we're supposed to be grabbing these vials of acid and throwing them at Frankenstein's failed prototype. If we throw enough of these, it'll enrage the creature and he'll smash this machine thing, giving us a piece of rusty metal to smack him in the face with. From there, we pretty much just whack the creature over and over again until Indy decides to weakly knock him over, presumably killing the creature and allowing us to grab the second fragment of the Mirror of Dreams, which it just had for some reason. Well, that was weird and kinda easy, let's get out of here before something like that happens. Great. Apparently, Von Beck survived his run-in with the alligator, and despite clearly being bit in the stomach, is somehow missing an eye. Beck steals our stuff, and then he and his minions take Indy to the next level for interrogation. So now we're in Istanbul, which used to be Constantinople, but now it's Istanbul, not Constantinople. While in our cell, we meet that random ninja from earlier, who turns out to be Mei Ying, that lady who hired us to find the Emperor's tomb and is kind of responsible for us being here. She tells us that the Germans are excavating some kind of lost city in search of the next mirror piece. She throws us the key for our cell and an unceremoniously backflips out of here. With that, we can begin the next level with some annoying combat. We need to beat up these guys so that we can escape and find our confiscated gear. The area leading up to our gear is pretty well guarded, but shockingly, an MP40 is a surprisingly effective tool at removing opposition. Now that we have our stuff back, let's talk about the level design, why don't we? I forgot about this in my script. It just says find a good meme to put here. After the first level, the level design in this game is, not great. It kinda just alternates between the same things, either just big open combat arenas or tight platforming sections. Another issue is the previously mentioned not making things clear to the player thing I was talking about. I'm not saying that everything needs to be covered in yellow paint or anything. I'm a YouTuber, not a games journalist. But it would be nice if the game let me know what I can do and gave me at least a little bit of guidance. This starting area of the Istanbul level is the biggest example of this in my opinion. We're supposed to progress by whip swinging on this lamp but there is nothing that tells you that this is even something you can do. The lamp just looks like part of the level's decor. How am I supposed to know that this is a gameplay element? Nothing makes that clear. Another example is right here, where you're supposed to push this box from this platform. Nothing says that you can do this. There's no indication that this box can be interacted with. It just looks like part of the level geometry. Anyway, we continue the level and learn that the funny German people have discovered the lost city where the mirror piece is hidden, so we need to hurry up and beat them to it. This entire area is pretty straightforward. We descend through some platforming, beat some dudes up, descend, beat some dudes up, spend 30 minutes walking in circles during a platforming segment because the game refuses to make the path forward even a little bit clear, beat some dudes up, all good. There's this big hole that we need to get down in order to progress. Luckily, there's a crane and a giant stone head here for us to use. This of course gives us an obligatory mid-2000s video game crane segment.
Now be the crane, be the crane.
We then jump onto the head and then get dropped by this random dude that appears from literally nowhere. Like seriously, where did he come from? We beat up the only other people here. Magically appearing Germans aside, we land in a pool of water somewhere deep underground and enter the next part of the level. This is a water level from here on out. We're gonna be doing a lot of swimming. This actually isn't as much of a death sentence as it seems, as we can thankfully grab an oxygen tank which extends our breathing time. We can also swim at Mach speed by holding down... Hang on, I gotta convert PlayStation buttons to normal people buttons. Circle, that's the one. Holding circle will actually speed up our swimming to the point of near uncontrollability. Like seriously, am I playing Indiana Jones or Superman 64?
Congratulations, Mr. Gillis. You have successfully beaten a dead horse at the detriment of your own video. Here's your award.
Oh, thank you so much. I've always wanted to get an award for making a joke that hasn't been funny in over a decade.
That's an odd thing to want.
I know! After speeding past some sharks that probably shouldn't be here, we can actually pick up a brand new weapon, that being the spear gun, a weapon designed exclusively for underwater combat, which we're gonna need as there's some soldiers in diving suits guarding some explosives we need to progress. Now, while land combat in this game may be an annoying, unfun mess, we can rest assured knowing that underwater combat in this game is an infuriating, unfun mess. The enemies are just as spongy as on land, requiring at least 2 to 3 shots from the spear gun to put down, but they also have perfect aim, and have the advantage of being able to walk normally while we're stuck doing our best Aquaman impression. Anyway, we grab the explosives and use them to knock down this pillar and create a ramp. This leads us to another obligatory mid-2000s video game crane segment. We lightly tap the stone head against this wall and open the path forward. Now here's where that whole the game doesn't make anything clear thing really comes into effect. We're supposed to find 4 different coins in order to unlock the door to the next area. The game does not tell us this, and the only reason I know that this is what we're supposed to do is because I stumbled into this room while trying to figure out where to go. The room with this coin door is at the end of 2 other rooms containing lengthy platforming segments and combat encounters. 3 of these 4 coins are hidden in the previous 2 rooms, meaning that we now need to backtrack to the other 2 rooms and search them for the path forward, which is its own annoying process thanks to the shark-infested water and the game's finicky platforming. Plus, some of these coins are hidden shockingly well, with basically no indication or clue as to where they could be, requiring you to basically just throw things at the wall and see what sticks. Eventually, I find all 4 of the coins after blowing up at least 2 pieces of historically significant architecture and getting bitten by sharks way too many times. With our coin collection complete, we can open the door, having only wasted another 30 minutes of my life. The next room features a giant, anatomically correct statue of Poseidon that I now have to sit and censor. Thanks for this, game! I really needed that. Other than that, there isn't too much to mention here. I beat up some naughty German divers and then blow up the giant community guidelines violation to access the final area of the level and our next boss fight. What are we fighting, you may ask? Well, allow me to just set this relevant Pirates of the Caribbean clip right here.
No joyful voice be heard. Let no man look up at the sky with hope. Ah! And let this day be cursed by we who ready to wait. The Kraken!
Yep, we're fighting the Kraken. This guy seems pretty dangerous until you realize he doesn't actually do anything. The only way the Kraken can actually kill us is if we get too close to it. To compensate for the Kraken's own inability to do anything, it'll spit these weird yellow jellyfish at us that will slowly drag Indy towards the Kraken's mouth. The jellyfish are kind of annoying, but luckily the game really doesn't want us to lose this fight because it gives us an upgraded spear gun with an excess of ammo, and lets us use the R1 button to instantly target the jellyfish. Plus, the speed of our swimming makes it so that even if the jellyfish do get a hold of us, they can only kill us if we set down the controller and do nothing. The only real challenge that this fight poses is to your patience and your ability to decipher esoteric boss fight design. The way you're supposed to defeat this guy is to use the first person mode. Yes, that exists, I just haven't mentioned it because it's basically useless. To target the Kraken's eyes and shoot them with our spear gun. I initially thought we just had to shoot the thing until it keeled over and died. We actually need to shoot the eyes until the Kraken retreats to its cave. Once that happens, we need to plant explosives on these four stone pillars. Thanks to the jellyfish and the limited time we have to plant the explosives before getting chomped in half by Squidward's angry cousin, this is very fun. This isn't even that hard of a fight if you know what to do and take advantage of all the free stuff the game gives you. It just takes so unbelievably long to get anything done. Just like real life! Eventually, I manage to blow up the four pillars, which for some reason only fall after they all explode. But hey, the Kraken's dead, I won't look a gift squid in the mouth. The Kraken's defeat conveniently drains the room and produces a staircase up to the third mirror piece. Oh, great, Mei Ying is back. She tells us that apparently that Marshal Kai guy she works for is actually the head of the Black Dragon Triad, the most powerful crime syndicate in China, and that he's working with the funny German people to find the heart of the dragon. Mei is actually an undercover agent for the Chinese government who is trying to sabotage Kai's hunt for the mirror pieces, but because Indy got involved and found the first piece, Kai is gonna double cross the Germans and take the heart for himself. So now we have to find the tomb before Kai or the Germans do. To do this, we're gonna team up with Mei to meet a smuggler in Hong Kong who will take us to Kai's evil villain fortress so that we can get the final mirror piece, which is actually the first one that we found earlier, back from him.
Hey, I found something!
Finally! Took you long enough. Some kind of locked box.
I could have told you that.
This must contain the next clue to the treasure. Come on, let's get back to the studio and see if we can get it open. Quick, get down!
What? Ah!
Search the area. I want them found.
Who the heck is that guy?
Dr. Villainous McBad guy.
Who?
The evil rival that I've totally had this entire time. He must be after the treasure too. We gotta get out of here.
What do we do?
Don't worry, the dude is pretty much incompetent. We're in no danger. Okay, maybe we're in a bit of trouble.
Oh god, we're gonna die!
Calm down, I'll think of something. Got it. How good are you at running?
Wow, that will show us right. These ruins are depressing. Wait a minute. What's that noise?
There they are! Henchmen! Move! Snail!
I'll be honest, I didn't think that far ahead. Nowhere left to run. Now, hand over the box. My god, I'm out of shape. Hang on. What's that noise?
I hear it too.
Now what?
My friends, come quickly!
Paper bag!
Where did he come from? Why is he wearing a fez?
Don't question the deus ex machina. Now come on!
This is the second time! How do we get out of here?
How long has he been at this now?
An hour and 46 minutes.
Dude, it ain't gonna open! Can we go home now?
No! I am not letting McBad Guy get to the treasure first. This box is the next clue. We need to get it open. Let's see, paper bag, you got any ideas?
There's a pound of plastic explosives in the back of the cart!
That'll work!
No! Oh.
Look, I'll see what I can do with the box. Why don't you get back to the game and see if it's got any help?
Fine. If it doesn't work, I'm having paper bag blow it up.
Yeah!
So anyway...
We open the next level in Hong Kong, where Indy and Mei are supposed to be meeting with a smuggler named Wu Han. He's gonna take us to Kai's evil villain fortress so that we can retrieve the mirror pieces, as well as some type of mystical weapon called the Pa Sheng. Cheng? Chang. I'm gonna say Chang. I don't know if that's correct. I'm sorry if I'm wrong. Seems Kai's found out about our plan, though, and we get attacked, causing Indy to Spider-Man jump into action and begin the level. We start with some mediocre combat that almost immediately devolves into running in circles trying to hit ninjas with wooden chairs. That's basically what the entire first half of this level is. Lots of really tight corridors and combat sequences that just serve to waste time. It's also full of doors that, despite being interactable, can't be opened and lead nowhere. These are common throughout many of this game's levels, so you better get used to hearing this voice line.
That's not gonna work. 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 That's not gonna work.
So anyway, we escape the theater after wandering through the building's catacombs, and discover Kai's henchmen abducting May. We also meet Wu Han, the smuggler we were supposed to find before we had to wander through 30 different hallways full of ninjas. Wu's got a rickshaw for some entirely unexplained reason, so we can try to catch up with May's kidnappers. We've got random henchmen on our tail, though, but luckily, we've got a conveniently placed Tommy gun to deal with them. Side note, during the cutscene where Indy picks up the gun, he racks it as if it had the side charging handle of the M1 Thompson, even though in first person, it clearly has a top charging handle, similar to the M1921 or M1928 variants. Also, when he racks the weapon, the charging handle appears to be on the left side of the receiver. The real-life Thompson M1 and similar variants have the charging handle on the right. Furthermore, well, I thought it was interesting. So now we're in an on-rails shooter segment. This section isn't necessarily not fun, it's more like fun adjacent. It's like the soy milk of fun. It's close enough that you can pretend it's the real thing, but deep down, you know that it really isn't. The main issue is how long it goes on for and how quickly enemies can kill you. There's no way to dodge enemies or recover health, so you basically have to just kill them before they can kill you, and pray you have enough health to get to the next checkpoint. After killing enough Chinese people to make Mao jealous, we reach the dock and discover May being taken aboard a German submarine. She's being taken to Kai's evil villain fortress, so Indy jumps aboard Wu's boat and we head to the next level. That level was pretty quick and easy. Sure hope the next one isn't a painful nightmare that single-handedly makes me regret wanting to make a video on this game. Yeah, you already know what this is, I'll skip to the point. This level is an absolute slog. From the very first area where you're constantly hounded by sharks, to here, where the game somehow manages to make mowing down Germans with an MG34 boring. The first two areas are more just annoying than anything else. It does a lot of the same things that the other levels have been doing wrong, namely poorly balanced combat, bad platforming, and confusing level design. But it's here, this segment right here, where I fully began to lose my patience with this game. If any of these enemies see us, then they'll pull an alarm that will alert all other enemies and summon these nearly unkillable Wolfenstein-looking flamethrower guys, who will not stop spawning until we deactivate the alarm. Even if we deactivate the alarm, we still have every single enemy in the area chasing us down. So if we get spotted, we might as well just embrace oblivion and start the segment over. If we want to get through here and progress, we need to sneak around and find a way through without letting any of the enemies see us. Do you understand what I am saying? This is a stealth section in a game with no stealth mechanics. This stealth section isn't even that long, it's only one room. What makes it insufferable is that we have no tools to combat any of the challenges in this section. Everything is working against you. You're basically just supposed to throw yourself at it until you manage to memorize the enemy's routines, and then you can just trial and error yourself a path out of here. Speaking of paths, trying to find the path to freedom from this purgatory isn't like trying to find a needle in a haystack, it's like trying to find a needle in 5 miles of Vietnamese jungle, complete with gunfire and the smell of burning flesh. On top of all of that, the door out of here can only be opened if the alarm is active. But behind that door is another door that can only be opened if the alarm is off. You wanna hear the best part though? You wanna hear the best part? The best part is that sometimes the first door will just be open for no reason. That's how I ended up actually finally beating this section after countless reloads. Victory only came by complete random chance. And after that, the level is over, and we get a meeting between Von Beck and Kai. So, we're just gonna move on from all of what I just suffered? Okay then. The bad guys have all 3 mirror pieces, but Beck and Kai are bickering over who's more of an incompetent buffoon. Kai walks off to go somewhere, I guess? I don't really know. He's got all the mirror pieces, though, that's what's important. Beck's getting fed up with Kai, though, and plans to get rid of him once he outlives his usefulness. Spoiler alert, this line of dialogue goes nowhere. Well, that cutscene's over, I guess. Now let's get back to the game. There's a security checkpoint that we need to pass. but we'll need a disguise and some security papers to sneak through. I hate this section, as much if not more than the previous one. If that was where I began to lose my patience, this is where I lost it completely. The entire area is crawling with enemies, and I had no weapons or ammo. And on top of that, I only had half health. The game hadn't given me a fountain to refill my canteen at any point in the entire level, so I had no options for healing. The alarm mechanic from earlier returns, and every time one of these godforsaken pyro cosplayers appear, an angel loses its wings and falls through the roof of a suburban home. The game does give you an MP40 and a decent amount of ammo. Yeah, it doesn't help at all. It takes half the mag just to kill one enemy, and it's guaranteed that one of them will reach an alarm and yep, there goes another one. The breaking point, though, was here, when I just decided to grab the MP40 and run through to the next area. You get locked into this area where you're supposed to mow down the enemies with this machine gun. One problem, I have no health, so I die almost instantly. And it's not like I can just die and start over with full health, because I still have to run here with the entirety of the Wehrmacht taking pot shots at me with Mausers and flamethrowers. They don't follow you to the turret section, but they do drain all of your health on the way there. So I have no healing, nowhere to run for cover, and no options. Here is where I decided that I couldn't keep playing like this, and I decided to turn the difficulty down to normal. This will be the difficulty I play on for the rest of the video. Christ, skill issue all you want in the comments, revoke my self-proclaimed pro-gamer status, I don't care. I want to get this video out and still have relatively stable blood pressure and a full head of hair. Lowering the difficulty didn't even change all that much because enemies are still massive damage sponges, and items are still as rare as a functional McDonald's ice cream machine. The only difference seems to be that I take slightly less damage, and at this point, I'll take that. Now I continue the level by running like the manly little coward man that I am to the turret section, kill some Germans until this gate opens, and then drop down this vent. After crawling through the fence like a more polygonal Bruce Willis, we enter the U-boat pen, which does not contain any U-boats, but let's just ignore that. Here we can do some more murder before grabbing those security papers we needed and then raiding the closet of the average Hearts of Iron 4 player for a uniform. Now we can get through the security checkpoint and finally conclude this cursed level. That was 2 whole hours of my life that I'll never get back. This game is getting kind of annoying, and it's not even helping me find the treasure. Speaking of which...
Hey, any luck with the box?
It's been open for like an hour now.
What? How?
The code was written in Sharpie at the bottom of the box.
Yeah, that tracks. Come on, let's get it open.
It's...
the other half of the map!
Wait. They put the one half in a game case, and they put the other in a treasure box and buried it in the middle of some ancient ruins.
Yes, of course! It's genius!
Why? Who even buried it there in the first place?
You're asking me too many questions that I'm not prepared to answer here, buddy. We gotta get moving quickly. It says here the treasure is buried in something called the Well of Lost Games. The heck is that?
The Well of Lost Games. The ancient legends say that all forgotten games are banished to the well, their developers having abandoned them long ago. The souls of these games rife forever in eternal suffering, begging to be released from their torment, their cries of pain falling on deaf ears. I gazed into the abyss of the well once, long ago. The horrific things I saw within it cannot be described, but the worst part is that it stared back. It peered into my soul. It looked deep within me, seeing all the darkness within myself. It was an experience I shall never forget. And I swore that day I would never return to that nightmarish pit of insanity.
So, can you take us there?
Sure, why not? It's just a little while down the road from here. Come on, let's go!
All right then, to the Well of Lost Games.
I'm really starting to regret getting up this morning.
Alright, we're here. Where's the well?
Right here!
The Well of Lost Games is a dumpster?
Yeah, what did you think it was?
Well, you have fun with that.
What?
I can't dig around in there, I gotta get back to the game.
Bye!
Well, sounds like she's having fun. Let's get back to the game.
Thanks to our impeccable and canonically Hugo Boss designed drip, we get escorted right to where we need to be, that being the German base, where we need to find a gondola so that we can reach Kai's evil villain fortress. While in the first area of this new level, I kick a random box in hope of getting some items, and apparently this was Hitler's favorite box because destroying it was enough to let every enemy see through my disguise and run over to kill me. So after I respawn, I avoid Hitler's box and crawl into the base's ventilation system, where there is just a random skeleton sitting here with a free MP40. The implications of this are terrifying, so let's just continue through the level. The vents lead to this generator room, where my disguise just all of a sudden stops working, and now I have to actually fight instead of just awkwardly walking by all of the enemies. We need to pull this random lever to divert power to the gondola so that we can continue onwards. This is pretty simple once you figure out the path through the electricity. These electric arcs are actually more of a help than a hindrance, because the enemies here will just run straight into them and die. We're gonna rock down to Electric Avenue. Okay, the lever is pulled and the gondola should be powered now. Then why is it not moving? Okay, just give me a second here. We're gonna rock down to Electric Avenue. And then we'll take it higher. Oh, we're gonna rock down to Electric Avenue. And then we'll take it higher. Okay, there was another lever I needed to pull. Would have been nice to have any indication of that, game. Thanks! Hey, so, Editor Reagan here, as it turns out, the game actually did give me an indication of where that lever was. There was, in fact, an entire dedicated cutscene to showing where it was. I just never saw it while I was playing through the game, and then I somehow never saw this while I was writing the script and reviewing my footage, and only just now saw it at 11 p.m. while I'm editing this video, so, yeah? So we beat up some more enemies and then ride the gondola, but unfortunately, the Luftwaffe has found us. Luckily, this other gondola has an MG-34 strapped to the roof of it for some reason, so now we have another turret section. This is another fun adjacent part of the game, where it's not technically the worst thing ever, but it goes on for way too long. Also, this gun seems to have no range. I can only take down planes if they're right in front of me, otherwise nothing happens. Well, that was a nice little break. Time for more suffering. I am getting so sick and tired of combat in this game. It started out as kind of irritating in the first few levels, but now it's starting to really take its toll on me. If I can't shoot the enemies, which I usually can't because it takes half of an entire magazine to kill even one enemy out of a horde of 12, then I usually just run past them and hope they leave me alone. They don't leave me alone. I'm still operating on only like a sliver of health because I haven't seen a single healing fountain for two whole levels, and I have to keep praying to the box gods for medkits. The box gods are merciful here, so after a few retries and at least one attempt where I died due to fall damage from falling into the next part of the level, thanks game, very cool, I make it to the next gondola station. Oh hey, a lever that we need to pull in order to summon the gondola. Now, what do you think will happen when I pull this lever and the gondola starts moving? A. We wait peacefully for the gondola to reach the station and ride it to the end of the level. B. A bunch of enemies spawn and I am already getting shot at. Well, that was annoying. Time for another turret section. This isn't really that difficult, it's kind of fun, but like I said earlier, it goes on for way too long. Once the ride is over, the level is finished, and we inexplicably find our way to Kai's evil villain fortress. The first stage of the level is infiltration. We need to platform and fight our way into the fortress. This is relatively simple, except for this whip-swinging segment that refuses to work. And this, children, is why God gave us save states. The next part of this level is primarily just running around killing enemies and trying to find which of the 40 doors lead to progress. I really hate these fake doors. Why am I able to interact with them if they don't do anything? Also, these armored guard enemies are maybe the most damage spongy enemies in the entire game, which is saying a lot because for half of this game, I felt like Flats punching SpongeBob. Anyway, the way forward actually requires us to pull this lever hidden in this random room that I ignored for the longest time because it just seemed like a random room. The lever will activate this waterfall thing, which I guess is just a standard feature in most suburban evil fortresses. We then need to find another lever that will turn off the water so we can take this path inside the fortress. This next area is just one big combat arena, where we need to find a bomb to blow up this random wall. The combat is annoying, but you already know that. I won't continue to assault a dead equine. Luckily though, I discovered the enemy's secret weakness, their personal kryptonite if you will.
waist-deep water. Yeah, if you just jump in this pool of water, they'll just bunch together and stare at you awkwardly. That means you can use this as a break area to heal and then jump up to deal with the enemies one by one. So I grab the explosives and then jump up here to blow up the path forward. This leads to the top of the fortress, where we need to climb up while being pelted with spears and crossbow shots. The platforming here is kind of finicky, but nothing uniquely painful. The camera is a little irritating, as is the jumping, but I'm kind of used to that by now. I've just gone fully numb. Now that I've reached the top, it's time to finish the level. Oh hey! It's May! I kind of forgot that we were supposed to be rescuing her, if I'm being completely honest. Apparently, Kai is planning to sacrifice her soul to Kong Tian, who is not a Chinese Donkey Kong variant, but is actually an ancient Chinese demon that he worships, I guess? I don't really know. The Chinese demon stuff kind of comes out of nowhere, and I stopped following the plot like 5 levels ago. Anyway, Kai walks off to go style his villain mustache, and Indy takes this opportunity to rescue Mei. Unfortunately, he didn't notice Kai's bodyguards and gets kicked in the stomach to start a boss fight. The red light, green light twins here are shockingly simple. They only have like one attack that doesn't hurt too much. The threat comes from their Mario and Luigi style bros attack, where they knock you into the air and then kick you in the face. But they can't perform this attack if, like when interacting with real women, you use the ancient technique of running away like a coward. At first, I struggle against these two because none of my attacks seem to be doing any damage. But then I realize that there are swords littered around the arena and sharp pieces of metal hurt people. So I stab the annoying woman and then we just cut away. The twins are just gone, I guess. There's no scenes showing what happens to them if they die or run away or whatever. It's just done. Like that. That may have been one of the most anticlimactic boss fights I've ever played. Well, at least we can rescue Mei and, in all honesty, I should have seen that coming. Well, the level's over, I guess. Let's check in on Grace real quick.
Hey, buddy, how's it going in there?
Ah! I found something! It was buried under Wii shovelware. Is this supposed to happen?
Well, don't just stand there, get it out! We found it. The greatest treasure that any Indiana Jones fan could ever ask for.
What is it?
Well, I will tell you what it is. It is mine. Dr. Villainous McBad Guy!
How did he find us?
How did we find them, Henchman? No matter. You will surrender the treasure now. Oh yeah? What are you gonna do, huh? Huh? We got the treasure. What are you gonna do? You gonna do some evil laughter? You gonna monologue at us? Huh? What could you possibly do to us? Oh, right, he has 2 henchmen. I forgot he has 2 henchmen. Enough of this! Henchmen! Load them onto the truck. We'll deal with them later. You'll never get away with this, McBad Guy. And yet, I already have. The time is perfect for the opening of the treasure, and with you out of the way, nothing will be able to stop me!
So, do you know what the treasure is?
Well, you'll see.
You don't know what it is either, do you?
No, I don't. But I'm sure it's very cool!
Oh my god, this is so stupid!
It matters not! If nothing else, I will have defeated you, as per the terms of our very well-established rivalry! Henchman, close the door!
Oh god, this is not good. Please tell me you have a plan.
Yeah, I got nothing. I gotta get back to the game.
You're still playing the game?
Yes!
Why? How is it gonna help us?
It's not. I'm just petty and I feel like I should finish it. So the next level begins with Indy falling through some conveniently placed debris before landing on a ramp. We need to slide down the ramp and then jump over to... Okay, let's try that again. We slide down and then jump over to... Okay, maybe I'm timing it wrong. Maybe I need to slide faster? Maybe I'm... No, you know what it is? The level must be glitched. That's what it is. I'll just quit the level and re-enter it. That'll fix it! I
I should be angry, but honestly at this point, I'm just so tired. I actually had to look up what to do here to see if I was soft-locked or not. Turns out I need to whip-swing across the gap. The only indication of this is this random lamp that looks like level decor. How am I supposed to tell that I could interact with this? So anyway, we go down a few more slide segments before dropping into the evil villain fortress's evil villain catacombs, where— What in the Christ is that thing? Spooky, scary skeletons and shivers down your— These ghost spirit things will possess these random corpses and attack us because, they're jealous that we have legs and they don't. These zombies are kinda irritating because there's like a dozen of them attacking you at any given time, but luckily the game gives you a torch that's highly effective against the zombies, which does give me some minor flashbacks to Friday the 13th, but luckily I'm great at repressing trauma, so it doesn't affect me too much. Our goal in this level is to light these magical lantern things with our torch to unlock this magical yin-yang thing. The first few lanterns require us to navigate around the catacombs, being harassed by the undead and getting stun-locked by lightning traps. The first of the two final lanterns require us to complete this wacky bridge puzzle, which is so easy I hesitate to call it a puzzle, because it's just stepping on these purple circles in the correct order. The other requires platforming across these invisible but also somehow visible platforms. Once all the torches are lit, we can complete one more puzzle to retrieve the Pa Cheng, that super important weapon that was mentioned like once earlier. This thing is probably the best weapon in the entire game. It does immense damage, can hone in on enemies when thrown, bounce off of multiple enemies, and can even generate a shield. Except I never really used the shield, so just ignore that. This is also the only weapon that can kill the flying skeleton ghosts, which is important because if you don't deal with them, they'll just possess something else and keep attacking you. So now that we have our new best weapon, we can fight some more enemies and then finally exit the catacombs. Now we have a scene from Temple of Doom, where Kai in his Chinese Emperor cosplay is going to sacrifice Mei to Kong Chen. Luckily, Indy intervenes and the room begins collapsing for some reason. Kai and his minions flee while Indy rescues Mei. They're about to escape when suddenly a Tetris piece falls from the sky and destroys the path out of here. Alright, this isn't great, but I'm sure we can... Huh? 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 Okay, so Mei is now a 90s fighting game character, I guess. I'm not really even sure what is happening at this point. The game has completely lost the plot. Mei is possessed by a demon or something, and now we have a boss fight. This fight is incredibly easy. All you need to do is hide behind these pillars to avoid her attacks, and then throw the Pa Cheng at her after she fires her laser. Once you do that, throw the Pa Cheng at the Dragon Balls, and repeat until victory. When all three balls are destroyed, the game will incredibly abruptly cut to an unconscious Mei. With Mei rescued and the complete Mirror of Dreams in hand, we can escape from the evil villain lava pit of the evil villain catacombs of the evil villain fortress. Now it's time to head to the penultimate level, the Emperor's Tomb.
Hey, that's the name of the video game!
The level begins with Mei and Indy climbing down into the tomb. We're told not to touch anything as it could be dangerous. However, I'm a disruptive influence and don't respond to authority well, so I immediately run over and spin this random pillar. This opens a door and has absolutely no consequences whatsoever, god dang it. To escape this trap, we need to climb on top of these spike pillars as they pop out. This is pretty easy to do, but pretty stressful because Indy climbs as slowly as humanly possible. After we escape the spike pit, we head through that door we opened and it leads to a room full of flamethrowers and whip swinging. You're supposed to time your movement to avoid the flames, but I can't be bothered and I just run through it. At the end of this room is a lever that opens another door. This leads to a room full of Red Alert 2 Tesla coils. I have no idea how you're supposed to avoid these. The game gives you skulls to throw, but these do literally nothing. I ended up just damage boosting and using the knockback from the shocks to cross the gaps. There is yet another lever at the end of the Tesla corridor that opens yet another door. This door leads to a combat arena, which normally I would dread, but because we have the best weapon in the game, it's barely an issue. The next room seems to have no obstacles, but when we equip the Mirror of Dreams, we see that the room is actually full of crushing walls and floor spikes. After the traps, it also reveals invisible platforms that we need to cross to progress. I'm not gonna lie, I'm kinda disappointed. I expected the mirror to be more important, considering how we spent like half the game looking for the pieces of this thing, and it's only used in one section of the second to last level. After the only use of the mirror, we fight some more enemies before Indy falls down another trap door. You'd think that he'd be better at noticing these things after falling through them every level. We fall into another combat section where we first fight zombies and then these possessed statues that are probably the easiest enemies in the entire game. This then leads to Simon, but with bells. This puzzle is very simple as long as you have a semi-functional memory. It's not even worth talking about. After the bell puzzle, we head deeper into the tomb, where we encounter Von Beck mocking us from off-screen, before he appears out of nowhere with a drill tank and now we're being chased. I hate chase scenes like this in most video games, and this one is no exception. The camera here is awful, and our view of Indy is often obscured by the robot arms of Beck's drill tank. So you have segments of this chase where you're supposed to react quickly to what's coming at you, but you can't because you can't see. You're also supposed to whip swing a lot, but because whip swinging is as reliable as my upload schedule, it's a complete chance if you're gonna fall to your death or not. Again, thank God for save states, because having to restart this from the beginning every single time I died would be maddening. So once you reach the end of the chase and swing to safety, Beck will just drive straight into the abyss and fall to his death. Look man, I understand you work for the Mustache Man and therefore are already not very bright, but this is a new level of stupidity. With Beck dealt with, we can finish the level by— OH GOD MY FRAME RATE! This video quality destroying monster is a portal to the Netherworld and the crypt where the Emperor is buried. I don't know why his crypt is in the Netherworld, nor why Indy decides to just run through the portal without a second thought, but I'm not questioning anything at this point, it's time for the final level.
My prince!
Paper bag!
You coward! You abandoned us!
Not at all! This was simply a part of my genius plan!
That is a lie and you know it!
You said not to question the Deus Ex Machina now.
Come on!
At last, the treasure is mine! And now to open it without any interruptions from—
Big bad guy, stop!
Curses! How did you escape from my unguarded and unlocked shed?
You kinda answered your own question there.
You can't open the treasure. Only the worthy may gaze upon it. The consequences could be devastating.
Do I look like a man who cares about the consequences of his own actions? I've had enough of your meddling. Henchman, attack!
Oh, don't worry, I'll handle these guys. Bonsai!
Why did he yell Bonsai?
Quick, we need to stop him.
Too late!
What's happening?
The treasure punishes the unworthy. The ancients have judged his soul and are displeased!
How do you know all this?
Quit asking questions and look away! You can look now. It's over.
Oh my god, what happened to his head?
It melted. Epic, right? Now come on, let's look at the treasure. Wait.
What's wrong?
I should finish the game first.
Why?
There's just one level left. I'm not gonna leave it uncompleted.
Here it is, the final level, the Netherworld. This level is very straightforward. You run along this path, fight some statues and skeletons, and then platform to the next area. Very simple. The combat is fine. Again, we have the best weapon in the game, and these statues are shockingly fragile. What's annoying is the platforming to the different areas. You have to spin these pillars to pull up these platforms. The platforms are only there for a limited amount of time, so you need to spin the pillars in a particular order so that you can platform without having the floor suddenly vanish beneath you. I just looked up the order to spin the pillars in because I'm tired of having to actually think things through. So we repeat the pattern of fight, then platform 3 times until we reach the Emperor's crypt. Here we need to navigate this invisible bridge by hopping to the correct platform when it appears. You remember all the way back in the first level, that adventure mode mechanic that had an entire dedicated segment to introduce it? This right here is the only other time that the adventure mode is used. The only time that this mechanic appears is in the first and last level of the game. Why did they even include it if it's only used for 2 levels? Why did it have a dedicated tutorial and name and all this stuff for it, only for it to be basically irrelevant? I know this is an incredibly minor thing to complain about, but I'm just utterly baffled by this. So anyway, with the only other adventure mode segment complete, we can retrieve the Heart of the Dragon, which is for some reason jammed in the mouth of the Emperor's dead body. I don't think you want to be holding that thing, Indy. It's been marinating in corpse juices for 1,000 years. That thing is more diseased than the average Californian. Yeah, I had to get one more jab at California out. I just had to do it, it called to me. So we've retrieved the Heart of the Dragon and attempt to escape the Netherworld. Unfortunately, Kai has followed us and shows up in his anime villain armor to seal the heart. Now he's all powerful or something. Mei shows up out of nowhere to help us, and this begins the final fight of the game. First, we beat up some statues before entering the final boss arena. Now we need to take down Kai and his inexplicable magic dragon. Kai is protected by a magic shield and will fly around attacking us with dragon blasts and homages to his favorite Johnny Cash song. To beat him, all we need to do is jump to these random glowing things to charge the Chang with magic energy and then throw it at him. Do this a few times and his shield will break. He'll then fall to the center of the arena where we can punch him 1 final time to complete the fight. And yeah, that's the end of the fight. There's no other phases or special attacks, just hit him a few times and he's done. It's really anticlimactic, but at least we get to watch the skeleton ghost give Kai the Dr. Facilier treatment. That's fun.
I promise I'll be your man! I promise!
Kai defeated Indy and May escape the Netherworld. We then cut to Hong Kong, where Indy and May are retelling the story of the fight with Kai, the Wuhan. Indy is upset that he didn't really gain anything from this adventure, his only consolation prize being May telling him that he has the gratitude of the people of China. Which doesn't really mean a whole lot, considering this game takes place in 1935, and China's only got a few more years before things get a little wacky and uncharacteristic. But hey, at least now Indy's got some sick Chinese criminal connections that I'm sure won't backfire on him in any way. Hey, did I mention that this game takes place right before the opening of Temple of Doom?
Well, that's the game, folks, and at this point, I think I'd rather watch Crystal Skull. This game has not aged well, and that's disappointing because I was really hoping this would be a good game. It does feel like an Indiana Jones game. It has the right tone and style and even a pretty engaging story, but the gameplay and design hold back any potential that it may have had. The enemies are massive damage sponges with way too much health and attack power, while the player feels weak in comparison and dies in just a few hits. Weapons and guns in this game are not fun to use. It takes guns way too many shots to kill enemies, and melee weapons break too quickly. The level design isn't any better either. It's confusing, and even the simplest of levels drag on for far too long. The puzzles are not fun. They're too simple and oftentimes just pad out the already bloated levels. I honestly think you could cut half the areas out of these levels and nothing of value would be lost. And like I said, I'm not mad per se, I'm just disappointed, because there were things I liked. The levels do look very cool, and there was clearly thought put into their aesthetic. And they are fun to explore when you're not running in circles desperately looking for the way forward. I also didn't really hate the game's story, because it was interesting. It feels like an Indiana Jones story, more so than anything done with the character recently, at least. Maybe a remaster or remake could bring the best parts of this game to the forefront and make something really special. But for now, it's a bloated, unfun mess that feels dated and painful. If you got some kind of nostalgia for it, then maybe revisit it. Just keep in mind it may not be what you remember. But for everyone else, there's no reason to dig up this relic. I give this game a final rating of 3 hats out of 10. Now, if you excuse me, I've got a treasure to go open.
Alright, here we go. Are you ready?
I just want to get this over with.
I'll take that as a yes. Let's see this treasure. It's a piece of paper. That's it. That's what we've been looking for this whole time?
Wait a minute. Where's Paper Bag?
Mr. Bag, I trust you've retrieved the package. Excellent. This is gonna make me thousands on eBay in a couple of years.
Hey, I held up my end of the bargain. Now hold up yours.
Alright, here you go. One Donjo brand round box with handles, as promised.
Sweet!
Now if you excuse me, I need to get this into storage.